And the title of my message today, it's The Heart of Worship. And we just finished our time of worship with that song. I'll talk about that song a little bit later. I had the privilege of meeting the author of the song and had a chat with him. It was very interesting. But let's go to the message, and I'd like to start reading in Daniel chapter 10, verses 11 and 12. And this is where we started 21 days ago, on the Daniel fast. Daniel fasted for 21 days, and after his season of fasting and prayer, he wanted answers from the Lord to a specific request. We know that an angel came and talked face to face with Daniel. And so we read from that conversation, the Bible says, "And he said to me, 'O Daniel, man greatly loved, understand the words that I speak to you and stand upright, for now I have been sent to you.' And when he had spoken this word to me, I stood up trembling. Then he said to me, 'Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and humble yourself before your God, your words have been heard, and I have come because of your words.'" So I like us to start this message, and the title of my message is The Heart of Worship, and I really want to talk about the life of worship, because we were called by the Lord to worship Him. That's who we are. As Christians, we need to understand what worship is. And so we're going to talk about worship. And it's only when men begin to worship that they start to understand God's will and God's plan. The angel addressed Daniel. Notice he addressed him by name. So his name was known in heaven. And my question to you is your name known in heaven? Because in order to be known in heaven, first you need to connect to heaven. And you need to have the forgiveness of your sins that only happens through the shed blood of Jesus. When you repent from your sins and you ask God for forgiveness, then your name will be known in heaven. And I want you to understand Daniel's principle in this season of prayer and fasting, because he got the answer he was asking for. He didn't receive the answer in the first day that he started his fast, and he didn't receive the answer in the last day. Because when we read the chapter, we see it was about the 26th of the month. We don't know exactly how many days after he ended his fasting that the answer came. But we know he fasted for 21 days, and within the days after he finished the fast, the answer came, and this angel appeared, and he told Daniel, "I have come because of your words. I have come because of your words." But before he said this, we can see on the previous verse, let me go a little bit further. He said, Daniel, man greatly loved. Notice there. Oh, Daniel, man greatly loved. Loved who? Where? Loved by whom? Greatly loved in heaven. So Daniel was loved in heaven. And you might say, everybody's loved in heaven. But how many are greatly loved? You know, in order to be greatly loved in heaven, you need to be in a close relationship with heaven. And you can do this through Jesus Christ. There was an attitude of worship in the heart of Daniel. So when the angel said, "I have come because of your words," it's not just the words, but it's the attitude of the heart. You see, words that we pronounce in the presence of God are not magical. We all, when we were children, we all have seen, you know, movies of legends and people that say magic words, abracadabra words that will open things, things will appear through these words. Let me tell you, those are legends. But reality and heaven reality, yes, it's triggered by words, but you need to have the right heart before the Lord. If you don't have the right heart, those words are meaningless. And words without worship will not trigger heavenly answers. Your heart must be in right standing with God in order to speak words in the Holy of Holies. And then when you speak those words, things will happen that will change your life and the life of others around you. Now, let me tell you that sometimes situations are bad. And there you might be the worst of your lifetime. And things might get into worst. And I'm going to give you a tip from the English dictionary. If you open up the English dictionary, you have there these two words, worse and worst. And this only works in English, doesn't work in French if you're under translation. But in the dictionary, in between worse and worst, there's a word. And the word is worship. All right? So, if you don't want things to go from worst to worst, guess what you have to do?
Worship.
Amen? You need to put something in between, you know, the bad and even worst, and that's worship. So we all need to learn how to worship. And the first thing I'd like to tell you today, when I talk about worship, and I want to encourage you to live a life of worship, is that you were planned for God's pleasure. We were planned for God's pleasure. In Revelation 4:11, it says, "You created everything, and it is for your pleasure that all things that exist and were created." It's for your pleasure. So when we worship, it's not to make us feel good. You know, I understand that we have lots of concerts in Montreal, and only this year we had Chris Tomlin, and we had Paul Baloche, and we had Michael W. Smith, and we had all these great artists that come, and usually they pack big conference halls and big churches. There's thousands and thousands of people that like to attend to these meetings. I'm one of them. I like to go there. But you know, it happens that some people are there just because of the quality of the music. Just because of the quality of the singing. Personally, I go there because, yes, I know there's quality and anointing in those psalmists that are coming to Montreal, but I'm not there to judge if they play well or if they sing well. I'm there to worship the Lord. But I understand when I'm in those places, those thousands of people, I see the majority have no reverence. They're there just, you know, it's like a rock concert, it's like a show. And they worship instead of worshiping the one who created us. Amen. So as we worship, we need to have to grasp this concept that worship is to please God. It's not to please us. Amen. This is why I keep telling and teaching these principles. And some people get upset with me when I say, you know, we can worship with any kind of song, because some people have this idea we can only worship with songs from the hymn book, and other people have this idea we can only worship with modern and contemporary songs. And I'm telling you, it's not the tune of the song, it's the tune of the heart. I can worship with any song. Just yesterday we were here and we just sang all songs. And we didn't have a huge crowd, it was just a handful of people. But you know, I mean, when Shirley Snow started to sing, and just with the guitar, and we worship the Lord, we worship from our hearts. And that's what's really important. And when you have this attitude, it doesn't matter if the worship team is not complete, if it's just the guitar and drums, you just worship. You're not staying in church just staring and saying, what happened today? There's no piano player. What happened today? There's no this, there's no that. That's the wrong attitude. That's the wrong attitude. Or if you just criticize and say, I don't like these modern songs, I only worship the Lord with old songs. Something is wrong with the heart of someone that cannot worship the Lord because of a song. Because our worship is more than singing songs. Our worship, it's a heart that is surrendered to the Lord, that is grateful to God, and that is willing to say, God, I love you, I worship you. Doesn't matter the tune, if it's loud, if it's low, you can worship the Lord if you have the heart of worship. Amen. Be better for the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now you were planned for God's pleasure. And the first purpose God gave is to bring Him pleasure. So He made you with the idea of enjoying you. You know that God loves your personality. God loves everything about you. Your ideas, your appearance, everything is unique about you. Maybe you think, well, I'm losing hair, I'm not as handsome as I used to be, or I'm overweight, or this or that. You know, God loves you just as you are. You were created for God's pleasure, so He loves everything about you. And when the Lord says we should love one another, the people that God created. So before you start criticizing others and tell them that you have a twisted nose, you're like this, oh, that one is ugly, that one is beautiful, I like that one, I don't like that one. Learn this principle that you were created to please God. Not only you, but everyone around you. And when you realize that God takes pleasure in you, you don't have to impress God. He loves you and He greatly desires to be with you. You don't impress God by praying for 1 hour. You don't impress God by doing, you know, prayers that seem very spiritual. We're not here to impress God. We're here to worship God. And we call this pleasure that we bring to God worship. And Jesus said, the Father is looking for anyone who will worship Him that way. And I'm going to read you this scripture that is in John chapter 4 and verse 23. It says, but the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship Him. Amen. The Father is seeking people that will worship Him in spirit and in truth. So when you cannot worship because you don't like the song, you're not worshiping in spirit, you're worshiping in the flesh. And when you worship in the flesh, yes, you pronounce words, but when words do not come from the heart, they will not reach heaven. They're just empty. They go up to the ceiling. This is why I can go to one of those concerts with thousands of people, and many times the music is awesome, but worship is not there. Listen to me. Worship, it's more than a song. It's more than a song. It's your heart connected with God's heart. And the understanding that Jesus Christ, His only begotten Son, died for you and for me. And because of Him, we can go into God's presence and just say, Father, Abba Father, Father, I love You. And you know what? God is looking for people. And my question is, can He find those people here at the South Shore Community Church? Can He find people here that have this heart of worship? Amen? Maybe you think that you're looking for God, but God first started the search and He's looking for you. That's why the Lord said, you didn't choose me, I chose you. So be aware, when you say that you've accepted Jesus, you didn't accept anything. He accepted you. He accepted you. Christianity, it's not a matter of accepting rules and regulations and to accept the rules of a church. Christianity is deeper than this. It's about an understanding that God, His eyes are searching the earth. Are searching the earth, and when God finds you, yes, He will place you in the church, but Christianity, it's not church. Christianity is not about church. Christianity is about a relationship with God. When God finds you and you worship Him from deep within your heart, give that hand of applause to the Lord. Now, to tell you what worship is, let me tell you what worship is not. So I told you that worship is not just a style of music. Worship is not for your pleasure, and worship is not a part of your life. It should be your life. Your life has to be a life of worship. And let me tell you, when you have sin in your life, you cannot worship the Lord. There's a barrier between you and God. And there's only one way to be forgiven from that sin. Your attitude must be repentance. And when God sees repentance, the shed blood of Jesus touches you and you are forgiven. Now you can worship. Now you have a direct line to God. Now you have a direct line to the throne. Now you can pray and your answer comes. Now you know that God is with you. Doesn't matter the circumstance. Now even in the middle of a great trial, you know that God is right there with you because you have direct access to the Lord. Amen. The heart of worship is surrender. You know, in Romans chapter 12, verse 1, Paul said this, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers. And this word, the appeal, is I beg you, brothers, by the mercies of our God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. This tells me that there is spiritual worship and worship that is not spiritual. There's the two kinds of worship. It's like, I don't know if this ever happened to you, but you go to a church and you feel awkward. And you say, this is kind of weird, this is strange, it seems that God is not here, it seems that the Holy Spirit is not here. I don't know if it ever happened to you. Sometimes it happens to me. You know, I can't find God in any church, because God is everywhere. So I don't depend on the church, but sometimes we feel kind of awkward. There's something wrong here. I heard this story of a famous preacher from Senegal. He has a huge church there, and he was invited to come to the United States, and he was in this huge church in a service, and they had the time of singing, and they had the time of praising the Lord and all these things, and then they called him to come to the stage, and he grabbed the microphone and he said, hello brothers and sisters, everybody, hello. He said, I want to tell you, when Jesus comes, this church will be the first one to go to heaven. And everybody started to applaud and cheering up. And then he said, because the dead in Christ will resurrect first. That stuff, right? This is a real story. This is not a joke. It seems like a joke. But let me tell you, some churches are dead in Christ. But when I mean dead, it's not dead for sin. People are spiritually dead. Spiritual worship will bring people from death to life. When we have spiritual worship, things happen. Healings happen. Revival happens. We have transformed lives. And we need to be in this point in which we worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Let me go to the end of my verse, of my message. But worship according to the Bible is surrender to God's will. Now, beginning with Abel and Noah, God smelled sacrifices. The Bible says God smelled the sacrifices of the victim. But you know that fear, pride, and confusion are three barriers that block your ability to surrender. Fear to trust God's control, pride to surrender your will, and confusion to submit to God's order. When you have these things in your life, it doesn't matter if you accepted the Lord 30 or 40 years ago. You are in a spot without communication with God. And let me tell you, your life will be a mess. Your health will be a mess because you're opening doors to the devil, and the only way to shut doors to the devil is to make sure that the house of your life is occupied by the Holy Spirit. And this doesn't come with words, it comes with worship. Worship. Tell the person next to you, worship.
Worship.
Oh, that's a command. Now, worship is becoming God's friend. And I'm about to conclude, but let me read this scripture in James chapter 2, when it talks about Abraham. And it says, was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see, that faith was active along with his works. And faith was completed by his works. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness, and he was called friend of God. Friend of God. You want to be called friend of God?
Yes.
You see, if you say Jesus is my friend and you have no works to show, what kind of life do you have? So many Christians, they have just empty words. They say, oh, the Lord this and the Lord that and the Lord this and the Lord that. And then there's a call to do something for the Lord. And they say, oh, I can't, you know. I have a very busy life and I can't. I cannot do this. God is knocking at the door. Are you listening? Faith without works is dead. Is dead. And God placed you in a church where you have pastors and leaders that will ask you to do some works. When you refuse to do works, guess what you're refusing? You're refusing to serve. And when you refuse to serve, you have no works to show. And one day, we will all be accountable to God. And when we get there to heaven, some people are going to have a huge disappointment. Because the book of Revelation says that some Christians will be left out. Jesus told exactly the same thing. That's going to be my last verse of the message. And I don't want you to be in that tough spot. I want you to be sure that you keep your salvation. And you only keep your salvation by doing works. And when you do works, you're a friend of God. Jesus said, I will not call you servants, but I will call you friends. And you will be friends if you do what I tell you. So they had to obey to a spiritual leader. When you disobey to a spiritual leader, guess what you're depriving yourself of doing? You're depriving yourself of doing God's work. You might say, oh, I'll do God's work my way. Let me tell you that the song by Frank Sinatra is not in our hymn book. I did it my way. You know, did my way, it's not for Christians. For Christians, we obey the Lord and we obey those that God placed in authority. Abram's obedience to God made him the friend of God. Now, Jesus, as I referred, John 15:4, told the disciples that they're friends. And Moses says in Exodus 33:11 that he spoke face to face as a man talks to his friend. Can you talk to God like you talk to a friend? I can. Many of you, I know that you can, because when we call a time of fasting and prayer, you say, yes, I'm there. I'm there to talk to my friend, to talk to the Lord. Are you a friend of God? When you're a friend of God, you'll receive words like Daniel. Daniel, loved in heaven. You are greatly loved, Daniel. Why was he greatly loved? Because he did the work of God. Not only because he had words, but he had works. You see, this is where some Christians don't understand, and they accuse churches like the Roman Catholic, oh, they only do works. They don't have the Spirit. Maybe they have more of the Spirit than some of us, you know, evangelical, because they're doing mighty works. And then people will recognize and say, oh, Mother Teresa, this one, that one, you know, and Brother Andrew and this and all that, oh, they do mighty works. Oh, they're people of God. Yes. Yes, they are. Yes, they were. What about you? Can you commit to the Lord to say, Lord, I will worship you with words, and I will worship you with my life. Tommy Tenney, my good friend, he wrote me and told me he wants to come to Montreal next year. He sent me a message on Twitter and said, Tony, it's time for me to go back to Montreal. Amen. You want to receive him again?
Yes.
Oh, what a promising man of God. And he wrote in God Catchers, your problems aren't too big. Perhaps your worship is too small. Think about it. Is your worship too small? You know, I like to go to fancy restaurants, and once in a while. Have you ever eaten in a restaurant for a special occasion, and they have three kinds of china and forks and crystal, and then you're very careful to not to embarrass yourself picking up the wrong fork and the wrong knife, and if it ever happened to you, you know, if it's just a four like this, they're all the same, I can pick up any. But I've been to places with eight different cutlery pieces. And I usually what I do, because I'm not used to go to those places, I'll let the person that is used to eat there to pick up first, you know, the fork or the knife, so I won't do a boo-boo out of myself. You know what I'm saying? You know, so have you ever been to these places? You know, for some people, church is like this. It's a lot of, you know, show off. It's you know, people will come and say, good morning, brothers and sisters. Here we are to celebrate the presence of the Most High God. And people do those. It's like a theater. It's so artificial. Some places and others, you know, through the centuries, they bring incense, and you know that they have long beards and they know funny hats, and they do all these things to the right, to the left, and that's a lot of protocol and etiquette, and if you don't do those moves, it's like God is not there. Let me tell you about a different God. Now, when I eat at home, this is not my family, but definitely, certain foods we eat just with a fork. The knife might be there, but, you know, it's there for show, you know. It's the fork, and then it's chicken or, you know, T-bone steak, it's the hands.
Yeah.
And we're with the grease coming out of our cheeks. I'm talking about this ending the fasting. So it could be a juicy end, and there's no fine china or crystal. So if we drop something in the floor, no problem, no big deal, you know. Okay, we just toss it in the garbage bin. And you see, God didn't design worship to be an expensive meal in a fancy restaurant. But God designed worship to be a moment of intimacy, a moment in family, a moment, a time to come together in a comfortable setting where you can say, Abba, Father. Father, I love you. I worship you. And if you're just, you know, concerned with side things, you miss the point. And worship is not church, as I told you. It's your life. It's everything you do. Now, years ago, someone did some bracelets, WWJD, what will Jesus do? And people were considering, you know, what will Jesus do in this situation? I don't need the bracelet. I ask all the time to the Lord, what will Jesus do in this situation? And Revelation 22 says, no longer will be there anything accursed. This is about heaven. But the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and His servants will worship Him. Who will worship Him? Servant. Who's a servant?
We are.
Well, we are if you serve. If you do not serve, I'm sorry. You'll get there, you'll get to the door, and they will say, you cannot come in. And that's really sad. One day we'll worship God face to face. This is a privilege for all of us. And John received the ultimate revelation about worship. And I don't have all the time, I don't have time to show you all the verses on this chapter 22 that talk about serving in worship. But if you read it at home, you'll see very clearly that worship is for servants, for people that have more than words, they have works. What works? You know, works like you look around in a church and question yourself, how many people are here in the church as an action of your direct ministry? How many people are sitting here in the church? They're here in the church because you invited them, or because, you know, we were a long time friends, they came from another church, or you talk about Jesus in the subway, in the metro. How many people are here that you brought to church? I know how many. And I can tell you this as your pastor, not to boast, I boast in the Lord. But since I've been here, the person that brings more people to this church is me. And that's very unfortunate. It should be you. And now this is very silent. I'm not telling you this to rebuke you. I'm telling you this so you can think about your own life. Because certain times, we spend time just saying, you know, I don't like what the pastor said. I don't like what that person said. I don't like what Jordan wears. I don't like this. I don't like this. I don't like that. What kind of words are that? What kind of words are that? I can understand that you don't like someone. But if you have words to show, you have authority to speak. If you have no words to say, you have no authority to speak. And one day, let me tell you, God takes these things very, very seriously. Same chapter of Revelation, verse 9. You know, John kneeled to worship that angel because he was so blessed. And the angel told him, you must not do that. I'm a fellow servant with you and with your brothers, the prophets, and with those who keep the words of this book, worship God.
Amen.
And we can think, oh, so he was telling, do not worship me, worship God. But there's something deeper here. John recognized that heavenly figure that was explaining him what was happening in heaven, in terms of a relationship with God and revelation of who God is, he was above him. So John thought, you know, this is a powerful angel of God, so I'm going just, you know, to kneel and worship. And he said, don't do that because I'm just like you. We're equal. We're equal. With whom? With your brothers, the prophets, and those that obey the word of God. Are you in this group?
Yes.
That's the question. If you're not, I want to give you now an opportunity to tell the Lord, Lord, I repent of my past and I'm determined to serve you. It's always a good time, you know, to have a new beginning. I finished this message right here when I was ready to take the airplane yesterday. And I was in Barcelona, this huge airport. There were literally thousands of people there. And everybody was holding a passport and a ticket. And we had to pass security. And as I was finishing, you know, the Lord just started to minister to me. And the Lord was just telling me, See, in heaven, it's going to be just like this. You need to pass security. You need to pass security. And you need two items to pass security, just like here. And I said, Lord, don't I need just one item, which is salvation? And the Holy Spirit just ministered to me. That's very vague. That's very vague. Yes, you are saved. That's your ticket. But you need something else. You need proof of citizenship. Amen. Ticket. The work of the cross. The shed blood of Jesus. Proof of citizenship. The heart of worship. Because you see, not everyone that calls me Lord, Lord will enter the kingdom of heaven. Not everyone that has the right words will enter there. You need to make proof that you are a citizen. Hello? Yes. You need two items. And maybe today you have one, which is your salvation, which is good. But proof of citizenship is obtained by works. In the church, we worship with songs. Outside, we worship with action. That's why in Isaiah 58, God says, the fast that I chose is to let the oppressed go free. It's to feed the hungry. It's to give clothes to the one who is naked. That's what Jesus said, when you give a glass of water to this person in need, you are doing it unto me. See, works. That's works. That's more than a song. Proof of citizenship. Now let me move further, because I had another verse, but I want just to finish. And I'm going to ask the worship team to come. And we're going to finish with a worship in form of a song. Okay? You want to worship the Lord with a song? Okay, so Matt Redman, it's a great author. And years ago, he came to Waterloo, Ontario, and I had the privilege of knowing him. And we were in a small setting, like, you know, just like this sanctuary. He usually plays in big sanctuaries. And he's just shared with a bunch of pastors and worship leaders something about this song, The Heart of Worship. And, you know, he's a very talented musician. And he was not an international singer like he is now. He was just a musician in a church, like some of our musicians that got promoted, you know, to this new level of international ministry. And they had amazing musicians in that church. And one day the pastor came to the musicians, the end of an amazing service, fantastic music, you know, the band, the singers, all professional level. Because we Christians have better music than the world. Maybe some of you don't understand what I'm saying, but in the church there's better musicians and singers than in the world. And some of the famous musicians of the world, they were Christian singers before. Mm-hmm. And we need to understand this. And Matt Redman, at the end of the service, had the pastor talking to him and the musicians, and the pastor said, you're doing this in the flesh. And from now on, you're going to stop, and I'm going to lead worship with my guitar for the next 2 months. That's not what's happening in our church, by the way. But he said, I'm going to worship with a guitar. And the musicians got deeply offended. Half of them left the church. They were really offended with the pastor. You know, musicians sometimes are picky. And they said, you need to sit down and worship in the flesh. And Matt Redman had this struggle. And he was saying, I'm going to leave too. You know, my friends are leaving to these other churches, other opportunities. I'm going to leave too. And for about a month, he debated, and he was looking at the pastor worshiping with a guitar, you know, singing out of key and all these things, and he was really upset. And while he was in that season, after nearly 2 months sitting down in a church pew, because you see, some musicians are in the church if they worship, if they perform. But if we tell them, today it's not your turn to sing, they will not come even to church. That happens here too. And I'm not sending any message to any person in particular. But I'm telling you, worship is more than songs. So he was sitting down in the church, and the Lord gave him the words, when the music fades, when everything stops, when I don't have to play, when there's no song, I'll bring you more than a song. Because a song in itself, it's not what you desire, Lord. That's the words of this song. And then he said, I'm coming back to the heart of worship.